today's topic is one that's going to hit a lot of nerves on some people, but validate others. Biblical principles on marriage. We see a lot of things happening in the world today that's trying to pervert marriage and all these crazy things. And the devil, I said before in my previous episode, devil's attacking marriage just because it's a godly covenant. That's really what marriage is. What they're trying to do today with changing man's law to make it other things, we're not even going to go into that subject because you know what I'm talking about. So I'm just going to share some word about what the Bible is saying biblical principles are. And then when I actually do a Bible study, which is about two Bible studies away, I'm going to get into some more detail and actually even more scriptures than I share it in the Golden Nugget. Golden Nugget, we're just going to touch the iceberg, with the tip of the iceberg with this Golden Nugget today, in terms of what the main scriptures are saying about what marriage should be about. And then that's why I said for some people it's validation. Other people, you know what? We better work on that. All right? So first of all, Father God, just thank you, Lord, for this Bible study, Lord, this brief Bible study, Golden Nugget. Thank you for everybody who's drawn to watch it either live or watch it at a later date. But bless them, Lord, that they may be able to take away some knowledge from these nuggets, Lord. They be able to bring them better understanding and bring them application to their own life or to someone they know in their life that they may be able to help with this Golden Nugget. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Now, the Golden Nugget I'm talking about today, really, I'm just going to focus on, there's four areas I'm going to really touch upon, and I'm going to actually read what the word says about each thing and then come back at the end so that we're going to start it out right from the word. And what the word is saying, I'm going to come from I'm going to come from Genesis first, then jump to Ephesians in two places, and then jump down to Hebrew. Now, all three points I'm going to bring about, I'll tie them together at the end. So let's just begin first with Genesis 1, 27, 28. So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on earth. That's how it all started, the covenant itself. Now let's jump over to the commission for both husband and wife. Now, right now, I'm talking about godly principles for marriage, but those of you who are engaged to be married, your mindset needs to be in what I'm saying right now, because if either side is not ready to commit to marriage as it is written in the word, you might want to take some counseling first. You might want to wait before you set the date. There's no rush in setting a date. No rush to get married. I had one friend say, well, you know, we were fornicating, and so we got married to stop fornication. What? How about I love you? You got married to stop fornicating, but was love involved in this, or was just sex involved in it? See, if you go into marriage because of sex, I tell you right now, you're dooming your marriage because sex is not what you're going to be doing 24/7. You got to be best friends. You got to love the person. You got to have some communication. You got to have trust. Sex is just an activity that brings the two closer. But a whole lot more needs to be going on in marriage than just sex to keep it fresh and to keep it long, give it longevity. Amen? Okay, let's go with the husbands first. Husbands, let me put my screen on a wider screen so I can actually give it, and not have to keep moving things. Wait, hold on a second. Let me put a rotation on here. Amen. Now, okay, let's jump down to, I'm jumping out right now to Ephesians 5, 25 through 33. Talking to this part right here. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water and with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. No one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does love the church. Now stop right there for a minute. Okay, that's what husbands should be thinking about their wives. Now, when we talk about domestic violence, excuse me, that has been broken severely. Wait, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Does Christ hit the church? No. So husbands should not be beating on their wives. Amen? Amen? So I'm just reading the word here. Don't blame those that get mad at the messenger. Hey, don't get mad at the messenger. I'm sharing the word of God about this right now. So if you're loving your wife as you love the church, or you're in a relationship that's about to go into marriage and you love your fiancé, see, the love that you have for your fiancé has to be working towards the love you have for your wife, because if you're going to get married, you need to be on the same page before you get married. You can't get married and then say, well, we need to get on the same page of what the Bible says. No, you should be on page what the Bible says during the courtship, and you're getting yourselves in line with the word as you plan for the wedding, so that when the wedding comes, you're in line with the word, and now biblical principles can be applied to your marriage itself. Now, let me go further, and then I'll come back and sum it up. Now, wives, be in subjection to your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is also the head of the church, being himself the Savior of the body. But as the church is the subject to Christ, so let the wives also be to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. And this is what leads into what I read before. So the first thing that comes into subjection there, when wives are trying to run the husband and be the head of the marriage, some people have a problem with that. When my wife and I took marriage counseling, the first thing they said, well, now there's some biblical principles that you guys need to understand and you need to be on agreement with before you get married, because I've had people even say, I mean, I have myself listed in different places to officiate for different weddings. It's a listing for weddings. And I cannot tell you that about 40% of the listings looking for an officiant to do their wedding said, do the wedding, but do not mention God. Wait a minute, do the wedding and not mention God? Marriage is a godly covenant. So when you're doing a marriage and don't mention God, don't expect people to say, God bless your marriage. Because how can you say God bless your marriage if you just said, do my wedding ceremony without mentioning God? What is it about your marriage that you don't want God to know about? And God knows everything anyway. But when you do a wedding without mentioning God, you're opening demonic activity to come into your marriage and destroy your marriage, because you're taking the blessings of the Lord out of what should be a godly covenant. Okay, so that's what's tying those two together. So when we have the domestic violence, like I said, that's a violation of both sides. Now, wait. Let me look at both sides of the horse here. Now, domestic violence, we mostly hear of course, is men hitting on the wife. But there are cases where it's reversed, where the guy is really kind of shy and subservient, and the woman is abusing the man. A lot of people don't want to believe that, but actually it can go both ways. So both need, now if a woman is following what it says, the husband is the head of the household. Now, head of the household doesn't mean you bossing him around. See, when you're husband and wife, you're working together. It says husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, being the Savior of the body. And as the church is subject to Christ, let the wives also be to their husbands in everything. Now, it comes down to ego things sometimes. Now, so for example, some men who may not be making as much money as the wives, if that's a fact, don't let that destroy your marriage. See, the devil will come in and say, you know, you ain't no kind of husband. You're not even making as much money as she is. And then on the other side, he'll come in and talk to the wives here. This ain't no husband for you. Look at all the money you're making. He should be making more money than you. What kind of marriage is this? See, that's why you got to have God in the middle of your marriage, your relationship. Because the devil will come any way he can to destroy your relationship from either side. So that's why when you got the Lord in the middle of it, both of you are holding on to the Lord. And as you grow older, the devil can't throw anything into your marriage. See, the devil doesn't want, whether it's men of God, men and women of God, or unsaved, he doesn't want marriage to work for anybody, because it's a godly covenant. That's why he's attacking marriages. And that's why I'm telling you, put the Lord in the center of your marriage, because he can cover the entire relationship itself. Now, I'll be getting more of this in detail. Two Bible studies from now, at the time of this recording, I'll be doing this as a Bible study, which has much more detail and much more scriptures to share. The last scripture I want to share right quick, which is very important to bring up right now, is Hebrews 13:4. Marriage is to be held in honor among all, and the marriage bed is to be undefiled, for fornicators and adulterers will be judged. Now, whoo, canworms coming out. Whoa, whoa, ah, no. See, that is very simple. Marriage bed undefiled. What the married couple does in bed is their business. But here's what I actually have a Bible study called Sex in Marriage, if you want to look at this in more detail. Because I get many questions. Well, what if I bring pornography into the bedroom and we're watching pornography to get us ready for sex? Okay, good advice, but that's a good idea. But this is a problem. If you do that, you're now letting the videos or magazines get you aroused and not your spouse. What that is doing is desensitizing the insensitivity you should have with each other because you love each other. If you get used to depending on videos or magazines to get you aroused to have sex with each other, then now when there's no magazine or video, who's going to get aroused? Because you're depending on outside sources. So when it says marriage bed undefiled, when you're bringing videos or magazines into your bedroom as a married couple, that's an outside source. So it should be a personal thing, because without those sources, you learn to love each other as each other. You learn to arouse each other as each other with just each other. So that's some advice I'm giving you, Mr. Fitz, in terms of that point of view that many people ask me about those questions. And of course, finally, before I close, the most important two things I think that should be in a marriage or in a relationship. Oh, no, excuse me. Let's say three things. Trust, communication, and honesty. Now, those three to me are the most important. There's about 10 in total, but those three right there, if you betray somebody's trust, overnight stand. I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't mean to do it. Okay, you didn't mean to do it, but it's 100% chance the person who's betrayed will never be able to trust you 100% again. It may take time to work even back up to 99%, but 100% will never be achieved again, because 1% will always say, will they do it again? It looks like they learned from it. It looks like they won't do it again. I'm hoping they won't do it again. But trust, you got to treat that like it's worth its weight in gold, because that is one of the most important element in a relationship and in a marriage. Amen. Peace. Blessed you. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Now, communication. Communication, you got to talk to each other. Don't say, well, you know, if I say this, they might think that, and then, well, I'm not going to mention that. No, mention it. See, if you both say, we need to talk, no, it'll work itself out. And then, no, we need to talk. No, it'll work itself out. The worst thing you can say instead of talking to a person is, it'll work itself out. Because what happened is, if you don't talk about it at the time you need to talk about it, 4, 5, 6 years down the road, that small point is going to come back like a mountain. And now all of a sudden, you two have grown so far apart, because that little tiny thing that was something that needed to be talked about has now grown to a giant oak tree and separated you so far, you need counseling to come back together. But if you talked about it when it first came up, then it probably would be solved by, you know, something as simple like, you know, you do this thing that kind of bothers me, and we need to talk about that because it really does bother me. Now, that's something like that. And the husband goes, well, you know what? I never knew that. I didn't know that you were sensitive about that. Okay, I'll stop doing that. But let's say you kept quiet and he kept doing that. Then you get more and more upset. And then all of a sudden you explode. And now you got a full-blown argument about something that could have been talked out when it was just a suggestion. Amen? And so those, and then I went in honesty. Be honest with each other. One of the questions in the premarital counseling session, and I'm about to close with this, the teacher said, if an old girlfriend called you on, this is back in the cell phone days, if an old girl called you on a cell phone, old girlfriend, would you tell your wife? And this one guy in the class said, well, no, because I won't get her upset. And then the fiance went off. What you mean you're not going to be upset? You try to hide something? You try to get a little something on the side? My girlfriend went completely off, almost ballistic in class. And he was going, well, but I didn't want you to get upset like you're getting upset. No, no, you ain't about upset. You trying to keep something from me. So, if you get something like that, the best advice, you know what? Guess who pays me? Yeah, blah, 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 blah. And then the wife goes, she still thinks she's going to get a chance? I thank you. You know what I'm saying? I said, no, this is over with. That's done. Baby, that's over with. I guarantee you. And I'm letting her know that's over with. See, that's the kind of honesty you got to be from both directions. When you hide stuff from each other, not being honest with each other, it's just like the other thing about the communication. It'll grow into a gigantic oak tree and end up destroying the marriage. And that's basically the golden nuggets I want to share today, because like I said, the Bible study, I'm going to get in a lot more scriptures and even more of the topic, because the golden nuggets is trying to just give you the tip of the iceberg on this topic. So, Father God, just thank you so much, Lord, for this lesson today, Lord. Thank you for everyone who's been able to watch it and absorb it and be able to either apply it to their lives or apply it to someone else's lives who needs it, Lord. And right now, if you don't know, I would got to end with a salvation prayer. If you don't know who Jesus is, that can help keep your marriage together, say this with me. Father, forgive me for the wrong I've done and the wrong I've been. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me and my sins. I want to be saved, Lord. I want Jesus to be Lord and Savior of my life. And from this day forward, I will not do a single thing in life or make a single decision in life without lifting it up to you first. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.